These days, with the breakup of the Soviet Union, we're hearing so much about all of these new countries. So I did some research into folk tales, and I have found three stories from these, quote, new countries. And I would like to share them with you and hope to expand your knowledge of some of these new countries. The first story comes from Armenia, and it was collected by the Newton librarian, Virginia Tashian, who is herself Armenian. Once there was, and was not, in ancient Armenia, a woman who lived in a distant village, and she had a husband, and his name was Hagsup, and he was the laziest man that you had ever heard of. He wanted to spend all his time lying around in bed. In the springtime, when it was time to plant the seed, she had to say, "Husband, Hagsup, get up, get out of bed, get out to our fields and start planting the seed." Very slowly, Hagsup got out of bed, and he took his sack of seed. He looked at his field. He wasn't going to bother to plow it. That would be too much work. So he would just put his hand in the bag and throw out a few seeds, hoping that the wind would carry most of them away so that he wouldn't have to harvest the crop when it grew up from the ground. When his bag was empty, Hagsup went back to bed. He lay there for months, and then his wife said, "Hagsup, the crop, it's grown up, and now it's time to harvest it." "Oh," said Hagsup. Very slowly, he walked to the field. What was this? The crop had grown, and much better than he had ever thought. It would take him days and days to cut it all down. Oh, he had to go back to bed. So he went back to his bed, and he lay there, moaning and groaning and short of breath. And finally, he stopped breathing. "Hagsup, wake up," said his wife. "Hagsup, what's the matter with you? You're dead." She called the priest. All of the neighbors took Hagsup to the church, and they laid him out in the coffin, ready for the funeral and the burial the next day. But that night, the wife started to think, maybe Hagsup isn't really dead. Maybe he's just faking it. I will go and test him. In the dark of night, she went to the church. She went into the dark, shadowy church, and she called out, "Come, all you newly dead souls. It is time for all the new people in heaven to get to work. Get your shovels, get your picks, pick up those heavy rocks, and let's get working." She said this again and again. And Hagsup, in the coffin, who wasn't really dead, sat up. "I didn't know you'd have to work in heaven. I thought all you'd do was lie around and rest. I don't want to be dead and go to heaven." So he jumped up out of his coffin and ran home. His wife was already there. "Hagsup, my husband, you are alive." "Well," he said, "when I found out how much work there was to do in heaven, I decided it was better to be alive and only have to harvest my crop." So he took his scythe and went out to the field to start working. Three apples fell from heaven. One for the one who asked for the story, one for the one who told it, and one for those who listened to it. Now, this second story comes from the country of Azerbaijan. Azerbaijan is right next to Armenia, and it is filled with high, rocky mountains. Mount Ararat is there, and that was where Noah's Ark was supposed to have landed. The people who lived from Azerbaijan were the Tatars and the Turks, and they are Muslim. in the mountains of Azerbaijan, there lived a boy named Razul. He lived up there with his old mother, and they were so poor, they didn't have enough to eat. So Razul said to his mother, "If we were to go to the city, I'm sure I could get a good job as an apprentice to a rug maker or a coppersmith, and we would make a lot more money. We should move to the city." "I don't want to," said the old mother. "I don't want to leave the home I know." But at last he convinced her, and he took their donkey, and he loaded his mother on top of the donkey and cages of the four hens that they owned. And they went down the mountain to the city. And before you know it, they were ensconced in a little mud hut outside the city walls. But there, I am sorry to say, they were just as poor as they had been up in their mountain village. Day after day, Razul went into the city. "Does anyone need an apprentice? I'm strong and hardworking. I can learn to do any job." "No, we don't need anyone." At last, the old mother said, "Razul, we have no more millet, no more grain to eat. You must take our four hens to the market and sell them, and with the money, buy us enough millet for another month." So Razul took the four cages that had the four hens in them, loaded them on the donkey, and headed towards the bazaar. Leaving the bazaar was a rich merchant. "What have you got there, boy?" he said. "These are four hens that I am going to sell." "How much do you want for them?" said the merchant. "Just a copper a beak," said Razul. "I will buy them from you," said the merchant, and Razul gave him the four cages of hens, and he held out his hand, expecting four copper coins, but instead the merchant made a fist and punched him in the face. "That's all the payment you're going to get from me, boy." And he took the hens and left. Razul vowed revenge. He followed the merchant back to his home. The merchant opened his gate, went inside his courtyard, and Razul stayed at the gate, listening. "Wife," the merchant said, I have four hens here, and I've invited some guests to our garden that's down by the river. I want you to cook the hens in that special way that you know, and to make your delicious rice pilaf, and the wonderful sauce that you put on it, and I want tea, and I want fruit, and I want wine, and I want our finest dishes, and I want our beautiful rugs all brought down to the river." "Husband," said his wife, "I can cook, but I can't carry all of that stuff down to the garden." "Don't worry," said the husband. I'll find some boy to come to the house and get it, and he'll do it for just a few scraps of food." So the merchant put on beautiful silken clothes and left to go to his garden that was down near the river. And Razul knew what he was going to do. He waited there with his donkey for a while, and then he knocked at the door. The merchant's wife opened it. "Yes, I'm the boy. I'm here for the food. Your husband sent me from the garden down by the river." "What? Already? I haven't finished cooking. Oh, but I could give you the rugs and the silver dishes to take down." So she got out the beautiful thick rugs covered with wonderful patterns, and she rolled them all up, and she gave them to Razul, and she gave him beautiful gold and silver dishes to take down. All of these Razul loaded on the donkey, and he took it back to the hut. "Razul," said his old mother, "where did you get these beautiful things? Did you steal them?" "Oh, no, mother. It's from the hen money," said Razul, and he left the rugs and the beautiful dishes at his home. Then he went back to the merchant's gate and knocked again. "What do you want now?" said the wife. "Is the food ready?" "Yes, I've just gotten it finished up." And she took out the spicy, beautifully cooked hens, the rice pilaf, the wine, the fruit, a samovar with tea, and all of these Razul loaded on his donkey and took it back home. "Where did you get this wonderful food? Did you steal it?" No, mother. It was the hen money." And they had a fine feast. Again, at the merchant's gate, there came a knocking. "Well, what do you want?" said the merchant's wife. Your husband sent me from the garden down by the river. I am here to get the rugs and the food. I already gave them to another boy. Are you sure you came from my husband? Oh, yes, indeed, lady. I've been tricked. Go tell my husband that someone has already made off with all of our treasures. And when the merchant heard what had happened, he was filled with anger. He left his guests there with no food, no rugs, and ran back home. I know who did it. I know who tricked me. It was that hen boy. The merchant went from house to house, seeing if he could find that boy who had tricked him, and it didn't take him long for the neighbors to tell him that he dwelt in that run-down hut outside the city walls. When Razul heard him coming, he took one of his mother's dresses and put it on, and then he took a shawl and tied it around his head and took a broom and started sweeping and was careful to keep his head down. The merchant said, "Hey, you, girl, do you have a brother who's a hen boy?"
"Oh, yes, sir, I do," said Razul, careful to make his voice high like a girl's. "My brother really tricked a very foolish merchant, and now he is in the mountains far away from here."
"And I know just who that foolish merchant was." So the merchant went back to his house, his guests unsatisfied, and his floors empty of rugs, and he had lost all of his golden dishes, and he began to learn his lesson about what happens when you don't pay the right price for things. And as for Razul and his dear old mother, they went with their donkey back up to their old village in the mountains, where they were surrounded by friends and family, and they lived very contentedly for the rest of their days, gazing out at the rocky mountains of Azerbaijan.
In an emergency, you don't have time to learn what to do and where to go. So be prepared before an emergency happens. Learn first aid and CPR. Put stickers on all your phones with the numbers of your local police, firefighters, paramedics, and poison information center. Find out where your nearest hospital emergency room is and know how to get there. For more information about preparing for emergencies, write the Will Rogers Institute, White Plains, New York.
This next story comes from Ukraine, or more specifically from the mighty city of Kiev. In the Middle Ages, Prince Vladimir held his court in Kiev, and all of the knights, the great bogatyrs, came to pay homage to Prince Vladimir, and there were musicians and lovely ladies. The court of Prince Vladimir at Kiev was very similar to the court of King Arthur. But to the east were the Tartars, the fearsome riding archers, who at any moment threatened to overthrow the city of Kiev and kill all of the people. The Tartars were ruled by the great Khan. Now one night, there was a wonderful party at Vladimir's court. Everyone was there. There was music, there was dancing, there was storytelling, there was fine food and drink. Everyone was having a wonderful time. Everyone, that is, except for Stavr. He was a merchant, a rich merchant, and he was also famed as a musician. He could play the sweet-stringed goosely and sing better than the professional musicians. But this night, he did not feel like singing. All he could think of was his beautiful wife, Vasilisa, his new bride that he had been forced to leave since Prince Vladimir had ordered him to court. So he sat there at the table, glum and unhappy. "What's the matter, Staver?" said the prince. "Are you jealous of me and my great wealth and power?" "Jealous of you? Why, no, my prince. I have a treasure greater than any of yours. My wife, Vasilisa, is the most beautiful woman in the world." "What? More beautiful than my own wife, Princess Aprixia? More beautiful than my niece, Princess Zabava?" "My Vasilisa makes them look like milkmaids."
"Indeed," said Prince Vladimir.
"And what is more," said Staver, "my Vasilisa is wise, wiser even than you, my prince."
"Throw that traitor into the darkest dungeon."
And the servants of Prince Vladimir took Staver off and threw him in the dungeon. Now Staver's servant had seen all of this, and he quickly hopped on his horse and rode back to Staver's lands to warn Vasilisa. There she was, walking up and down in the garden with her long golden hair and her dark eyes as bright as a falcon's. The servant told her what had happened. "And you say Staver has been thrown into a dungeon? Why? What did he do?" "He was bragging about you, my lady. He was bragging about your great beauty and your wisdom." "Oh," said Vasilisa, "let me think. Prince Vladimir will demand a huge ransom for the return of Staver, far more than we could ever pay. And the servants here are old and weak. We could never bring him back by force. Therefore, I must bring him back by cunning." "All right. Go saddle the swiftest horse we have. And you, Sasha, my dressmaker, I want you to make me the clothes of a man. I want you to make me the clothes of a Tartar nobleman. A golden kaftan and high boots. And my maids, cut my long golden hair quite, quite short." The knights of Prince Vladimir rode to Staver's land, and as they approached his land, a figure came riding towards them very swiftly. It was a small, slim young man with short golden hair, dressed in a golden kaftan, dressed as a Tartar nobleman. "Oh, there," said the soldiers of Prince Vladimir. "We are approaching the land of Staver. Where do you come from?" We're going there to bring his wife, Vasilisa, back to the court at Kiev." "You are too late," said the slim young man. "Vasilisa has disappeared. I myself am going to Kiev. I am the ambassador of the Tartars. I am the nephew of the Khan, and I go to see your prince to demand from him 12 years of the golden ransom. If he does not pay me, I will tell the Tartars to burn Kiev to the ground." The soldiers reported back to Prince Vladimir. "He's coming. He's coming to burn Kiev to the ground. We did not kill him, mighty prince, for he was wearing the clothes of a nobleman, and he said he was the nephew of the Khan. And if we killed him, the retribution upon the people of Kiev would be great indeed." Just then, the slim young man strode into the palace. "Good day to you, Prince Vladimir. I come from the Khan. I am Ambassador Vasily." You may be of the Tartar people, said Prince Vladimir, but your golden hair indicates that your mother was of our people. That may be true, but don't expect that to soften my heart. I am here to tell you you must pay 12 years of golden tribute, or the Khan will burn Kiev to the ground. And I have another demand. I wish to marry your niece, Princess Zabava. At that, Zabava tugged on her uncle's sleeve. Uncle, come here. Listen, Uncle. That is no man. That is a woman. Listen to that silvery voice. Look at those small, shapely hands. Look at the way he walks. It's a woman. Nonsense. That is the Ambassador Vasily from the Khan. Quiet, girl. Now, Ambassador Vasily, would you like to rest? We Tartars never rest. Well, I have heard that you are fond of wrestling. Would you care for a wrestling match? Why not? The ambassador said. So he was led to the great courtyard, and Prince Vladimir called out his strongest warrior. Wrestle this young man, but be careful not to kill him. The great wrestler strode forward, and he looked at Vasily, and Vasily looked at him, and the wrestler darted forward and grabbed nothing but air. He lunged again at Vasily, and again he missed, and then Vasily moved forward and grabbed the wrestler by the arm and threw him to the stones. What did I tell you? Vladimir said to Princess Zabava. Did you see that? No, no, Uncle. You don't understand, said Princess Zabava. What you saw didn't take strength. It just took cunning. Another test, said Prince Vladimir. You Tartars are said to be very skillful archers. What say you, Ambassador Vasily, to an archery contest? I would enjoy that. I have brought my curved bow. I always enjoy shooting. So Prince Vladimir called forth all of his archers. 12 of them lined up. The targets were set up. 12 shot their arrows, and only 7 hit the targets. The targets were moved farther away, and the 7 shot again. And this time only 2 hit the targets, and one of them was Vasily. What say you? He commented to the other archer. Do you see those leaves on the oak tree? See how there are 2 of them high up there? Why don't you shoot at one and I will shoot at the other? They're too far away, said the Kiev archer. I can't hit that. But, he said, looking at the prince, I'll try. So he took his bow and shot and missed. And Vasily's arrow sent the leaf flying over the palace wall. A third test, said Prince Vladimir. What say you to a game of chess? I like the game, said Vasily. So the ebony and ivory chess table was brought out, and the gold and silver chess pieces were brought forth. How about a wager? Said Prince Vladimir. If you win, I will give you the city of Kiev, and I will be your slave. But if I win, there will be no 12 years of golden tribute. All right, said Vasily. They played one game, and then another. Vladimir won one game, Vasily won one game. Vladimir won one game until it was down to one last game. Checkmate, said Vasily. I have lost, said Prince Vladimir. My city is at your feet. I did not mean to risk the lives of my people. take my life instead. No, said Vasily, I don't want your life. Only give me the hand of your niece, Princess Sabava. That will be a reward enough for me. That night at the banquet table, Sabava looked down and said nothing. And Vasily looked down and said nothing too. He was thinking of prisoners in dark dungeons. Some music, great prince, would cheer me up. Have musicians play for me. And musician after musician played song after song. Oh, said Vasily, I have heard the howling of wolves that sounded better. I have heard that you have one musician who plays the sweet-stringed goosely better than anyone else. Stava, said Prince Vladimir, bring him up from the dungeon. Stava, thin and wan, was led forth. He looked at the ambassador. You are?
I am Ambassador Vasily. We knew each other as children. Come, I will feed you. I will give you something to drink, something to eat. And then you may play for me on your sweet-stringed goosely. And after Stava had eaten and drunk, he picked up his stringed instrument and began to play. He sang a song of his wife, Vasilisa. He sang of her beauty. Prince Vladimir thought that is what started all of this in the beginning. And as Stava was playing, Ambassador Vasily left the banquet hall. When he returned, the ambassador was gone. Gone was the golden kaftan and the high boots. And there stood Vasilisa, the beautiful, in a lovely dress and soft shoes. All that remained was her close-cropped golden hair.
My love, said Stava, what has happened to your hair?
It was the golden rope that pulled you out of prison, my love, she replied. Prince Vladimir, this is my wife. Is she not fair? Is she not wise? Oh, Stava, I have to admit, she is the fairest of all. And in this instance, she is wiser even than your prince. Go and live forever in peace and happiness. And Stava and Vasilisa returned to their lands, where they lived happily.